I'm going to talk to you today about an aspect of my research, which is chromium from Northampton's old leather industry in our river here, the Nene. Specifically, what can we learn about the industry in the past by looking at the river, and what can that tell us about the management of tannery waste today? Okay, I'm not actually a leather student, I don't know much about leather at all. I'm in the School of Geography. But my PhD is looking at fine sediment in the Nene, and it aims to quantify the sources and movement of fine sediment and its associated contaminants. So when I think about associated contaminants, of course, Northampton's big leather industry was always going to be a big one of those. So it kind of presented an opportunity for me to work with the school and leather here and kind of benefit from each other's expertise. Now, I've included two pictures on this first slide. The red one here is a river in India, and it's red because of the tannery effluent being released into it. The second picture is the river Nene, which I took here well over, so just emphasising the point we're not talking about it's quite a nice place. Okay, so what are the questions I need to ask when thinking about chromium? Well, the first one, obviously, is are there actually elevated levels of chromium in the river Nene? Second one, where is the chromium and how does it move? And the other one, what does the Nene Basin tell us about the management of tannery waste today, perhaps in places like India we've just seen with the growing leather industry? You probably all know this a lot better than I do, but I've included it. Chromium was first used in tanning back in the early 20th century. I put a statistic here, one tonne of hide gives us about 10 to 50 metres cubed of wastewater, with concentrations up to 150 parts per million. But as you know, we don't really release that. With the proper treatment, we can bring that concentration down to effectively zero. And the other point to emphasise here is chromium is a pollutant, but the form of the chromium is very much important to its kind of toxicity. So trivalent chromium we use for tanning is not particularly toxic, but hexavalent chromium is. So moving on to Northampton specifically, chrome tanning was first introduced in the 1930s here. Now before that, for quite a few hundreds of years, Northampton had been a centre for leather production. After that, the industry started to grow past the 30s, and by the time we get to about 1956, we've got nearly 1,800 people employed by it. Growth continues on until the 70s and 80s, where we kind of reach our peak. But around this time, profits begin to slide, and a few people have said leather talks reasons that might be cheaper leather abroad, and Northampton had a big shoe industry, which also declined at around the same time. So there's a lot of customers disappeared. And by the time we get to about 2002, there's only 7 kind of concerns left in existence. I don't think most of those are tanneries, I think a lot of them were maybe dressers or indirectly involved in the leather industry. Okay, so we've established Northampton had a big leather industry, and there was a potential for a large amount of chromium waste to be produced from it. So how do we get from that to chromium in the river? I've listed 4 ways there. First one is discharge of the waste straight into the river. If you recall in an earlier presentation, we saw the open drains in a city with the tannery effluent flowing through them. That may well have gone straight into a river untreated. Second way is what's common in Northampton's old leather industry. So we've got discharge of waste, maybe treated, maybe untreated depending on the time period, down through the sewage system, it's treated in the sewage works, and that effluent from the sewage works is often discharged into the river in controlled amounts. Third one is the erosion of contaminated lands that may be in the vicinity of a waste area or a tannery. And fourth one is leakage from improperly sealed landfill. Now today, if we want to put something at a landfill site, we'll put an impermeable membrane on the edge of the site, so we know none of the material inside will leach out of the water. Back in the past, that didn't always happen. We had people building landfill sites on permeable rocks and aquifers, so a ready amount of water flowing through the waste in there, out through and back into the river, bringing any contaminants such as chromium with it. I've included 3 pictures here. See, the one at the top here is a basic treatment facility, typical of what we may have had in the 1950s in Northampton. It is just what it looks like, a hole in the ground. And it's just a basic settling tank. So moving down to the picture below that, we have a conventional kind of treatment facility. I'm not an expert on tanning, but I'm hoping you kind of recognise that as being the sort of thing you'd see. And this is what we might have found in the 70s and 80s in Northampton's industry. And just to complete the picture I've included here, the last one is a treatment facility in a modern tannery today, sort of ultra-modern facility. So you can see over time a distinct improvement in the treatment of the waste. So we've established the chromium can enter the environment, but let's have a think about what happens to it once it gets there. So we'll start off with our tannery effluent in the corner here, and take into account at this point the treatment can remove some of our chromium. But in the water we have an aqueous kind of dissolved form of chromium 3. Now the toxicity occurs when, given the right oxidizing conditions, the right conditions, some of that will be converted to chromium 6, the hexavalent chromium, which is our kind of major pollutant we're concerned with. A two-way arrow here, so it's kind of a backwards and forwards process. But it's very dependent on the actual conditions in the river. It's quite funny, you may not get any hexavalent chromium at all. So our aqueous chromium 3 is in the water, and it will quickly come into contact with some solid particles in the river. So I've listed a few here, so we could just have clay particles, perhaps some organic matter. Northampton's geology is quite mixed in iron and stone, so we get iron minerals in the river. And again, we've got a backwards and forwards reaction there, so the chromium will quickly associate itself with these particles, will react with the chemical groups. And as a result of those reactions, we get an immobile form of chromium 3. So we have chromium attached to solid particles in the river, and we can call these fine sediment, hence the relationship to my PhD. I've just put this point at the end, that the reactions you see with the aqueous chromium 3 and the particles in the river are very much biased in favour of the chromium being formed into an immobile form. So it's very easy for the chromium to meet an organic particle, react with it, and kind of become immobile. And it's very, very difficult, often kind of really impossible for it to get back. So we'd expect to find very little kind of chromium after, say, a few minutes or hours actually dissolved in the river. So we've got our chromium contaminated sediment. Let's think about, this is a picture of the Nene basin I've drawn here. Well, about half of it, it's the area that I'm studying. So once you get to about Peterborough, it kind of flattens out and isn't very interesting, so I'm not going to look at that bit. I chose that myself. So we've all made it here today, so I'm assuming you know where Northampton is, and that's kind of right in the middle of the map. We've got the major towns here, Wellingborough, and if once you get to the just off the edge of the map, you need Peterborough. And just a bit more context, if you look at the very north in the middle, there's the town of Market Harbour just off the edge of the map as well. You notice that there's an area very... So there's an area of very raised ground around the edge of the kind of Nene basin. We also have a lot of hills here. We have our main river flowing through Northampton, flowing through Wellingborough and the major villages around there, and then out to Peterborough and the sea. Now let's take this map and place on it some of the major tanneries which used to be in Northampton. I know there were a lot of them, but I think the really big ones. So here we go. What we can see is the tanneries are mostly located in the town of Northampton, Wellingborough, and the villages surrounding Wellingborough. Now we know water doesn't flow uphill, so I don't think it's unreasonable to assume that none of the waste from these tanneries here could have got to these higher ground the hills up here. The only area it looks to me that the waste could directly get from the tanneries is in the main river channel from Northampton onwards, and to the flat ground next to the river, which is a floodplain and will flood once every year or two. So it's narrowed down our kind of target area a lot. So we've kind of identified the areas of the Nene Basin which may be at risk, but let's talk about the individual parts of it. We'll start with the riverbed, which is just what it sounds like. It's the bottom of the river channel, and it's often made of gravels. And it's important because it's a major breeding site for aquatic life. And we included this graph here. And this is a study done up in the River Ouse, up in Yorkshire, I think. And it's just over the months, it's the amount of sediment and the amount of chromium associated with the sediment and how it changes. You see it's very, very variable over the months. But there is a trend of, in these first 5 months, February to December, we've got a gradual build-up of the amount of chromium on the riverbed. And that's until we get to about September, when there's a storm or some flood event, and that all washes the sediment that's built up in the chromium, and washes it through the river system and out the other end. So it almost scours the bed of contaminants every flood. The same study highlighted that a very small proportion of the sediment moving through the rivers actually finds its way onto the bed, and it's about 3%. But as I said at the beginning, it's very important for aquatic life to breed in, so it's a major place we need to consider. Back in September, I went to a few places around Northampton and took some sediment from the riverbeds and just tested it for chromium to see what I could find. The first two sites there are Northampton and Wellingborough, and if you recall on the map, you saw there are a lot of major tanneries in these towns. Compare that to Kettering, which is kind of up north on the hills, and there weren't any major tanneries there, and we're finding there's quite a bit more chromium there. But there's two things we need to consider with this. I also took a sample of the soil, which is on Northampton's ironstone geology, and that's well known for being very rich in metals. And what I actually found is that's naturally higher in chromium than the sediment I found on the riverbed. So it may be we're not, this chromium on the riverbed has nothing to do with leather tanning. We also have to consider the graph we saw in the previous slide, that the amount of chromium on the riverbed is very, very variable from month to month and the amount of sediment there. So is one sample taken from the riverbed going to be representative of the whole? And personally, I don't think it is. So moving on, we'll talk about suspended sediment. If you look at a river and see it's all kind of muddy, you can't see the bottom, that's why it's just the sediment actually being transported by the river at the time of sampling. Mostly when people sample this, they'll just walk down to the river, take with a bucket, take a big lot of water, filter it, and then analyse the resulting sediment for chromium. I've included here a picture of an Environment Agency flow gauge station, which they very kindly let me use to monitor suspended sediment. And the Environment Agency is the government body responsible for maintaining the water quality in our rivers, and they're the people who will look for any pollution if it's there. And they've been very kind in giving me this data. Now, these graphs show the dissolved chromium, so if you recall, we'll talk about the forms of chromium. This is the chromium that's actually dissolved in the water, it's the aqueous trivalent chromium. And the records start from about the early 1980s, so you can tell from the beginning we're already missing a lot of data from the peak of Northampton's leather industry with this. And we can also see the data points there, and they're very infrequent, so you only get one or two samples a month. So if we consider the amount, the variation in bed sediment from month to month, it's going to be even greater in the amount of suspended sediment in the river. So it's not going to be entirely representative, this data. But if we look at it, we can actually see a trend. The first graph at the top is in Northampton, so if you call a lot of tanneries in that area. And the second graph below it is in a major village near Wellingborough, so again in a major tanning area. In both graphs, when we get to about 1987 or 1988, we get a sharp drop, and it stays reasonably consistently low after that. So it may, we may be seeing the end of some of Northampton's major tanneries in this data, with a sudden drop at that time point. So this is from the same data set, and rather than dissolved chromium, it's the chromium associated with the sediment in the river. And the first thing that surprises us is we have even less data points there, and we have even less of a time frame. But again, we can kind of see a trend of gradually decreasing concentrations of chromium over time. Because I see we've got up to 5,000 times more chromium associated with the sediment than dissolved in the water. So if you remember the points that the reactions of chromium with solid matter solid matter in the river are very much biased in favour of immobilising the chromium, this data is kind of backing that up. And to put like, the values the same here in context, the study that I talked about before, the river ooze, cites about 5 to 124 parts per million of chromium as being a natural background level. So we're kind of above that level, but the Dutch government have set this limit for sediment in rivers, and the max safe amount of trivalent chromium there is 1,720 parts per million. So only at one point, about 1987, do we exceed that. Most of them are well less than half that. Now moving on to another sort of suspended sediment. See a picture here, and this is a flood in Northampton a few years ago. See a lot of water on the field, this has come out of the river, and you see it's very muddy water, so we've got a lot of sediment suspended in this. It's been shown in a few studies that about 10-50% of a river's total amount of sediment transported can end up on a floodplain like this. And also I'd say it's what will happen is the water will move the sediment onto the land, the water will recede, but the sediment will stay on the land. So we're actually producing a long-term store of the sediment and any contaminants which are associated with it, such as our chromium. And we may get about one or two of these floods a year. So just to summarise that part of the contemporary sampling, sediment movement in any river is highly variable from month to month or time period to time period. So measurements taken in a single session are likely to be not very representative, so a bucket from the water, just one sample of sediment off the riverbed. And we can also say most sediment moves in large kind of flood flash events. See this diagram here is looking at a few rivers and the amount of sediment that moves. The arrows coming off the side are kind of floods and overbank flows. The small kind of blob bits coming off the side are the channel beds. And the different rivers have very different amounts kind of deposited in the flood. So we've kind of seen some of the modern day sampling, but we've seen a few problems with that, as in it's very variable over time, so you have to sample all the time to get a representative picture of any contamination in the water. You've only got data from when you started sampling, so if you want to know about Northampton's old leather industry, and we've only got data going back to the 80s, then we've kind of missed most of it. You can maybe see the tail end. So what can we do to kind of remedy this problem? Well, here's one option. What you see in the picture here is a sediment core. And what the person who's taken this has done is gone to a place where sediment builds up over time. So if you remember the picture of the flood, we've got a lot of sediment being transported over the riverbanks and left there. Imagine over successive floods, we've gradually get a build-up of layer upon layer of sediment. So we could go, and this person has, and take a core from that, then slice it up into slices and analyse each slice for whatever contaminant we want, such as our chromium. So hopefully this will provide a longer time period and a more representative sample, so we'll be sampling a larger time period rather than a single bucket of water. So back in, I think it's about March last year, I went to this site. This is near the village of Stanwick, which is just downstream of Wellingborough. So if you recall, we had Northampton with a lot of large tanneries, then we have Wellingborough, which also had a lot. And we just went slightly past that, so any effluent coming from these tanneries into the river would flow through this site. What you see here is a little lake. It used to be a bend in the river, but over time it's been cut off. But it's not entirely cut off. We have a little channel kind of at the top of the lake, still connecting it to the main river. So all the time water's flowing through the river and a small amount is entering our lake. And it's going to drop its sediment in the lake and we'll get a gradual build-up over time. So we can take a core from there, analyse it for chromium, but how do we know? It's not much use if you don't know what date each part of the core corresponds to. I'm going to quickly go over this because it's quite an in-depth thing and it's quite dull, but I'll hopefully give you a good background on it. We use a natural radioisotope, which is lead-210. Now, back when the Earth was forming, a certain amount of radioactive uranium was trapped in all of the rocks around us. And over time, some of this will decay, and it'll keep decaying through different elements until it turns into radon and radium, which are both gases. At that point, it can leave the rocks, and we get this radon entering the atmosphere. Now, it doesn't stay as radon either, because that will, over time, decay into our lead-210. So we have the radon decaying into lead in the atmosphere, but the lead isn't a gas like the radon is, so it will rain down to the Earth's surface. Now, this process is constantly going on at a steady rate. So we have our lead raining down on the surface, attached to any sediment moving, and kind of it will move with it and be trapped in our floodplain core. Now, every 22.5 years, half of our lead will have decayed because it's not a stable element itself. So if we look at any part of our core and compare it to the maximum amount today, say if we've got half the amount of lead, we know that sediment in that part of the core was deposited 22.3 years ago. So we can get a rough estimate of how old our sediment is there. The second method, which is a lot kind of easier to use and interpret, is cesium-137, which is another radioactive element. But this one's man-made. So back after the Second World War, everyone was very keen on developing nuclear bombs and nuclear technology and testing them. So we had a lot of nuclear tests going on, and this cesium formed during the tests. Like the lead, it's formed in the atmosphere and will rain down onto the Earth's surface. So we can take our sediment core, slice it up into pieces, and look at how much cesium is in each piece of the core. Unfortunately, we know the date of some of the largest nuclear tests, some of the nuclear incidents. So the graph you can see on this page is the core I took from this lake at Stanley, and I've analysed each part of it for the cesium. So you can first see the big peak. Now, back in 1963, the year of the Nuclear Test Ban Treaty, for some reason there was a really, really large number of nuclear tests. So, whenever we see a huge peak, the biggest peak, that's is safe to always associate it with 1963. So we have a date marker for near the bottom of our core here. After time, it kind of levels out, we don't have much, until we get to about 17 centimetres down. And the incident around then, it's the year I was born, was Chernobyl. So we've got another nuclear incident there, and we can attribute this small peak there to that. So in our core, we have two independent date markers. So what I've done is taken the sediment core I took, analysed it for chromium, and given each part of it a date. So you can see from the bottom of this, rather than the contemporary sampling, these dates go back to the kind of mid-50s. So we've got a record of chromium going back that far. And what we can also see is very high levels of chromium in the 50s, but once we get to about the 60s, it drops to about half the amount. And from the 60s to present, there's maybe a slight downward trend in chromium concentration, but it remains reasonably consistent. So I found that quite odd, especially considering in the introduction I said Northampton's leather industry didn't peak until about the 1970s. You might know better than me why this is, but the reason I think it is, so if you recall, we saw the pictures of the different treatment facilities, and going from the 50s to around the 60s and 70s, we went from a simple pit in the ground to a settling pit to a much more elaborate modern day treatment system. So it may be that the kind of cleanup in the 60s due to the improvement in kind of treatment technology. And if you recall as well, I talked about the different forms the chromium could be in. So it can be aqueous, and it can react with the different sediment constituents. So what I did, I just tested the core for spherical exchangeable chromium, which is chromium that's really free to move, and I didn't find any of that. I also checked it for carbonates, so anything bound to, say, like a chalk particle or something like that. And again, I didn't find anything there. It took until I tested it for the chromium associated with organic matter and that associated with iron and manganese oxides before I found any. Now, if you recall, when you tan a piece of leather, the chromium generally doesn't come back out of that. It's very tightly bound up. And it can be thought of as a similar process if it meets a large kind of piece of organic matter in the river. It's almost a tanning process. The organic matter will be tanned. So we can be reasonably sure that the chromium associated with this, given quite extreme conditions in the river, isn't going to be coming back out or interacting with the environment or doing anything. So I'll summarise this. The concentrations of chromium I found both on the riverbed, in the suspended samples from the Environment Agency, and in the historic cores are all well below the safe limits. So it doesn't look like there's any dangerous amounts of chromium in the Nene Basin, which is good, I think. The historic chromium I did find, and there is a store of it which is built up over time, is in what looks like a very immobile form. So even with oxygenating it, like swirling it around in the river, it's reasonable to assume not much of the chromium in there is going to come back out, and virtually none of it is going to come back to hexavalent and chromium and be a major pollutant. The other things to emphasise are investigating the movement of things like chromium from tannery waste is a very complicated procedure. You can't just go to the river and take a sample off the riverbed. You can't kind of take a sample every month and kind of the suspended sediment because you may miss the flood when most of it moves. And the last point is investigating historical sediments can give us a more representative sample, so we'll get gradual buildup of sediment over the year in all types of flow. And it can also fill in gaps of data, so just because we don't have records going back in Northampton to the 50s, doesn't mean you can't go to a site like this now and actually collect some. I'd just like to acknowledge these people for their help on my work, and thanks for your attention.